Jen mentioned, this project, my journey with Seattle Seniors really started quite a while ago. I was volunteering and interning while an undergraduate at UC Santa Cruz, and I remember meeting with Tim, trying to come up with a senior project, and somehow we came up onto the topic of tool use, and I was interested, but I was like, surely it's been done to death. Surely we know everything there is to know about sea otters and their use of tools, because it's such a well-known behavior. And there's just something about tool use that people grasp onto. It's something we can do for a long time. It was thought that humans were the only ones capable of using tools. Clearly that was not the case. So I'll be talking a little bit about what I learned with that master's, with the thesis I did, as well as what has happened since then. A lot of other people have kind of taken on this topic and have found a lot of other interesting things. So like I said, it used to be believed that only humans were able to use tools. We now know that it's much more diverse. It's still considered rare, but there's a wide variety of species that use tools. And most of these species are using tools for a very particular reason. These New Caledonian crows will actually select the correct size of their stick to kind of fish for insect larvae in tree trunks. Capuchin monkeys will use stone hammers to break open nuts. And some of these nuts even have oils that would be an irritant to the monkey if they tried to break it without a tool. And then there's also bottlenose dolphins that will use sponges to protect their rostrum while they're hunting down on the seafloor for fish. These fish do not have swim bladders, and that particular habitat that they're looking for them, echolocation won't really work. So all these examples, they've really developed a specific reason why they're using tools and how it will benefit them. Now, of course, there are also times when it's appropriate not to use tools. We all eat finger food. And to try and eat this with a tool would actually possibly make it more difficult. I have not tried this, but I don't think I'd be very good at it. And then there are other foods that either require a tool or culturally we're expected to eat a certain way. And if you haven't developed that skill, your feeding is going to be pretty inefficient. I love Joey, he's awesome. So sea otters pretty much use one strategy when it comes to tool use. They have one object in their paws and another object that they're pounding against. But the tool itself can vary quite a bit. Most commonly are stones as either an anvil or a hammer. They will also find human-related objects. The one on the left has a glass bottle that it's using to break open a mussel, while the other individual is using part of a boat in the harbor. Thankfully, it was the middle of the day, so the boat owner was not there sleeping. But they can also use prey items themselves, such as pounding mussels against each other, or I think Jenna's favorite is sometimes they will pull off the crab claw and pound it on the rest of the crab carapace, kind of adding insult to injury. Yeah. So when I started my project, we had some very basic questions. There was a lot of intuition about what we were expecting to find. And there were some surprises along the way. So basically what we were looking at is, do all sea otters use tools? If there are some differences, what may be driving those differences? And how are these tools helping sea otters? So to start, we looked at kind of a larger scale of different populations. We had a number from the northern sea otter subspecies and the southern sea otter subspecies here in California. So that pink band represents relatively the current sea otter distribution. We had two populations that we looked at from the Aleutian Islands. And on the next page, I'll be showing a bar graph, and there'll be color-coded bars. So Aleutian Islands will be in green. Southeast Alaska, we had two populations. Recently, Aaron Reichsteiner from British Columbia has been very nicely recording tool use as well. And we've all, Jenna, I, and Michelle Stetler have also gone up there to help with that, and she graciously shared some of her data. And then we had four populations from here in California. So just, again, first look, we want to know how often were these auditors using tools in these different areas. So on the bottom, we have all those different populations, and the y-axis is the frequency of tool use. And probably right off the bat, you'll notice in the Aleutian Islands, they very rarely were using tools, less than 2% of their dives. Compared instead to Southeast Alaska, which was around 12 to 14%, similarly, British Columbia, and then a little bit more variation in California, but still somewhere around 18 to 12%. And it was interesting to note that Southeast Alaska and British Columbia were actually more similar to California, despite being genetically more similar to the Aleutian Islands. So we started looking at different things that might explain these differences. Things like different ages and sex from our samples. The one we really expected to explain a lot of it was the type of prey that they were eating. So you probably, a little bit from that video, but otters eat a really diverse array of food. And they have different defense mechanisms. Some of them are very soft-bodied, and once the otter gets it up, it's not a problem to eat. Others have spines, claws, they like to fight back, and others just have thick, hard shells. So we expected that otters would respond to these different prey items differently. Now, one prey item you may notice is missing from here is the abalone. Unlike in that video, we really do not expect otters to use tools for abalone at the surface. This otter was really fortunate. She got an awesome abalone. Once it's up, the meat is, the foot is very much exposed, and otters can just eat it up. They don't need to break the shell once it's at the surface. However, like we saw in the video, they do seem to use tools underwater to help them dislodge the prey. And at the surface, we'll see that in the form of broken shells. Unfortunately, this isn't always as obvious, and it's not wasn't really recorded consistently. So in all of our analyses, we had to exclude abalone prey items. But we do know that they do use tools for them, but it's not in a visible format currently. So getting back, we looked at how sea otters, how often they were using tools based on what prey item they were coming up for a particular dive. This one is averaged for all of those different populations we just looked at because they all followed the same pattern despite being so different in their overall frequency of tool use. So snails, in particular, were the most common prey item where they were using the tools, whether you were from California or the Aleutian Islands. And it's progressively decreased with mussels and other bivalves, such as scallops being the next most frequent, and urchins and soft-bodied prey items, barely any tool use at all. So Chris Law is a PhD student currently at UC Santa Cruz, and he's been looking at this a little bit more. He's been looking at the bite force of sea otters, as well as how much force is required to break open some of the prey that they eat. So on the left-hand side, along this line, is less force required to break open the prey for crabs and urchins, whereas large scallops are at the other end of the extreme. That orange line is the theoretical bite force limit that he calculated by looking at the skulls of sea otters and their musculature. So those top three prey items that we were seeing otters use tools with are all beyond that limit, which suggests that if an otter tried to use their teeth to crush one of those turbid snails, they either couldn't do it or they may injure themselves in trying to do it. And so this just really reinforces this idea. Otters are responding to the prey item that they're eating, and that really coincided with what we were seeing with this first pattern that graph I showed just a few minutes ago. In the Aleutian Islands, those green bars where we barely saw any tool use, at the time the data were being reported, almost 75% of their diet were urgent, so they don't need to use tools. Whereas Southeast Alaska and British Columbia were much more clam and mussel dominant diets, and California showed a lot more snails compared to these other populations. Now, if you've been to any other sea otter talk in your life, you've probably heard the idea that what we're seeing at the population level is not necessarily what we see at the level of the individual. This is something Dr. Tinker talks about a lot, so if you want to hear more about it, I'm sure he'll discuss it tomorrow night, at least in some form. So at the population level, we may see individuals eating all these different prey items. But when you get down to the individual level, you may find that certain individuals will focus on just a few of these prey items. Now it's important to note they still eat other things, but something like a snail may make up over 60% of their diet. And an individual hanging out right next to another one in the same area, one is eating snails primarily while the other is eating urchins primarily. One of the questions we got a lot after our first paper came out was the role of genetics at that more individual level. There's some evidence that these different diet specializations are passed on from mom to pup. And we got this idea from the bottlenose dolphins, the ones that use those sponges. That actually only happens in one population, and there was one female grandmother that started doing it, and she taught her daughters how to do it, and so they can actually track that with genetics. So we thought, maybe sea otters do that too. So we had some tagged animals that we were able to know their diet, know how often they use tools, and we had genetic samples that we could test. We did not find any real strong, clear genetic patterns. They were kind of all over the place for all the different diet types, as well as how often they use tools. And one of the conclusions from that paper was that sea otters have been using tools for so long, any marker like they saw in the dolphins would no longer be present from the samples that we had. But there was still some question about what is really driving this tool use at the individual level. We know prey type is definitely a strong part, but we were still getting this noise in the data that wasn't explaining. So again, going back to diet specialization, particularly for these snail specialists, we would expect them to use tools a lot simply because of their prey item. But part of the specialization also means becoming really efficient at eating your food. So in this picture, that little pink thing in the middle of her chest is her rock. And if you look just above that, kind of towards her armpit, that is a small turban snail. She has another one in her paws. These prey are not big. They have to, as we've seen, they have to crack them open to get to the meat. There's not much meat inside, so they have to eat a lot of them to get all that caloric requirement. So sea otters and particularly snail specialists need to be really efficient at what they're eating. And so when we looked at these snail specialists in particular and looked at their rate of intake, that's exactly what we saw. So in red is the snail specialist when they're eating snail prey. They're much faster at getting all that food in compared to a non-snail specialist trying to eat a snail. But they're not just super feeders all the time. When they're eating non-snail prey, they're not doing quite as well either. So just like we did at the population level, we looked at how frequently were they using tools when they're eating particular prey items. Were they following the exact same pattern? Or were they using tools all the time or something different? For simplicity, I'm only gonna show you snail specialists versus urchin specialists, but all the other diet types followed similar patterns. So when we looked at the snail specialists, as expected, when they're eating snails, they're using tools almost 100% of the time. And they use tools a lot more for those large, you know, scallops and other bivalves and clams. But overall, they use tools a lot more compared to the other diet groups. So in purple are the urchin specialists. They were less likely to use tools for any given prey item compared to the snail specialists. So this kind of divide is kind of weird. And basically what it boiled down to for the snail specialists was that when all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. They were really good at using tools for those snails, so maybe they were struggling a little bit with that urchin. Well, I have a rock right here, I'll give that a try. And overall, that's probably not that big of a deal. But one of the things we predicted was that because they were so specialized with using this tool and using it in times when maybe it's not the best opportunity, they may be less likely or even just slower to change their diet as different prey abundance also changes in the area. And this is something we're possibly starting to see right now. We're doing a project, a collaborative project with UC Santa Cruz and USGS with a recent increase in the urchin population that has been going along, that we've been monitoring along the peninsula here. And so we have some tagged sea otters that we're monitoring and collecting foraging data and looking at their tool use. And one of the hypotheses is that with this increase in the urchin population, otters will be switching and starting to focus more on urchins as well and responding to that. However, we have at least three or four individuals that are still very much snail dominated in their diet. So we're going to keep watching them. Maybe it's just taking them a little bit longer, or maybe they're just going to keep eating snails even though there's urchins all around them. That may be a little bit better option, but they just don't know it. So there's still a lot more to learn. I think in the video they mentioned, picking your own tool. Do sea otters select for different attributes for their tool, or are they just picking any rock that they can find? Chris is continuing his work, which is also going to include how much force are they able to exert on those prey when they're using those tools compared to the bite force or any other strategies. And really more about how they learn to use tools, how much is from the mom, how much is from individual learning. So yeah, if there's any students, here's some project ideas. And with that, thank you very much. Watching them as they're swimming, bouncing around in the swell, and trying to identify what they're eating and how, whether or not they're using a tool.
Thank you very much.
The beauty of sea otters, and it's really unique among marine mammals and maybe for any species that we're trying to observe foraging, is that they go down to the bottom, they choose their prey, and then they come to the surface and they put it on their belly and eat it at the surface. So really have a unique opportunity to be able to see, identify what they're eating, how big it is, what kind of tool they're using, how many different prey items they have. So it's really kind of an unprecedented situation for being able to actually make observation, direct observations of foraging. For tool questions?
Just on the force required chart that you showed, snails were required on the roots, then the others were without. That muscles required more than them. You get the tools on muscles was less.
I think part of that is related to Chris's current sample size. That project is still ongoing and he's still collecting prey to do that test with. Especially in elk horn slough that you're clearly familiar with the Washington clams. sometimes we see them use a tool, sometimes they don't. So how much variability is there in that shell strength for those prey items? Snails, especially those turbid snails, seem much more uniform in their size and, you know, probably in their shape. So it may be that snails are just consistently always too difficult to break open with your jaw, whereas a bivalve, maybe you can crush it a little bit more differently, and it doesn't require as much force that way. I also don't know the size of the muscles that he used in his test, and that could have something to do with it.
Well, like you said, there's really only one way to bivalve.
Have you reached any conclusions on the female and mother as in on her food selection to her pups? I mean, you know, a number of, she breeds over years. But, you know, she has quite a population of offspring, if that's the case. Is that one of the things you're still working on?
I would say it's something we're still working on. Even though we are able to see them give birth, we're not always able to follow the pups once they wean and see what they eat. We do have some, but yeah, it's still.
Is it? Yeah, okay.
Right. There is definitely, you know, a previous study that Michelle Stedler was involved in did have some evidence of that, that I'd be curious to see, you know, if that is still the case with larger sample size or, you know, with more in-depth following of those individuals.
Yes. So just wondered, there was a slide that showed that the urchin, the otters that like urchins use the tool to eat their snails, like very little. So were they successful or?
Yeah, I mean, there are some other snails that it could have been those, but they might have been successful, but it took a little bit longer, or maybe they came up with it. And then they weren't successful. That is definitely a possibility as well. I would say for the most part, I don't see non-snail specialists eat snails. Like, even if they do try and use a tool, no.
I've seen it a few times, and when I have seen it, it's really rare.
Yeah, I mean, it definitely happens.
But the few times I've seen it, they've been super uncoordinated. So if you watch a snail eater eat snails, it's just, they're machines. They're just absolutely efficient and very, they have a really tight rhythm. And a few times I've seen a non-snail eater bring up a snail, they're throwing it over their shoulder, they're dropping it over here, and the pieces are flying this way, and they really don't know, they aren't very efficient at how to open them. Yes, we have a
So snail specialists, is that all they eat? And if that's mostly what they eat, how many snails do you have to eat to get 20 pounds of food?
I have not done that calculation. I've wondered about it.
Michelle, do you know?
I mean,
they'll come up with 30.
Yeah, in a single diet, they can come up with 30.
And one dog.
And we'll watch them, you know, for an hour.
They're a little
pocket.
So I have a question that relates to that.
Okay.
So I hear a really common myth about sea otters and tools, that they pick a tool with their pups, and then they keep that tool in their pocket for their entire lives. So I don't know, would you like to address that particular myth?
I have seen an otter use multiple tools within a single forage bout. So within like 20 minutes, they have three different rocks. I think Terry has once seen an otter sleeping, and there was a little something in her, you know, stuck in her armpit in her pocket. But overall, no, they definitely do not keep the same tool for their life.
They might keep the same tool for a forage bout, though. For
right. Yeah, it could be for a single forage bout. I had one otter that we used to watch. Her pup would like to steal the mom's rocks, so she had to keep diving down to get new ones. So.
Any more questions for Jessica? Yes.
In the wild, do otters often carry food in the folds under their arms? Does that happen in the wild?
Yes.
snail one, she had more in there that we just couldn't see, and we'll often see them kind of roll, and all of a sudden they have a new prey item that you didn't see before.
So it's usually food that hasn't been shelled yet that they're storing in there for later?
Right, yeah, it's new food that they have not processed and consumed yet.
Urchins, kelp crabs.
Yeah,
Have you guys started looking at tool use frequency in Elkhorn Slough?
I did take a look at it. Again, it's a little bit different. The diversity of prey is not the same as most of these other populations were rocky, intertidal, kelp forest habitats. In the slough, it's mostly clams of different types and some smaller crabs. So the overall frequency was, I think, about 10%, which is still within the range of what we saw in California overall. But like I mentioned, we could watch an otter, and even though they're coming up with a Washington clam each time, maybe one of those times they use a tool. I don't know why that is. They also, up in the slough, there aren't really rocks as much availability as we see right along here. So we'll see them use shells or other clams as their tool.
The perfect individual that I was filming using tools would be feeding from Washington clams.
Mm-hmm.
Then the next week I showed up with another individual, I guess, also eating Washington clams, but no tool
but
use.
No tool, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's, you know, along the peninsula, I can go a whole day and not see any tool use. If I do see it, it tends to be one individual that's using it constantly. In Elkhorn Slough, it seemed to be, I could go to a spot and I'd see someone use a tool, but maybe only once. So there's something different going on there that I think is really interesting. Whether it's me or someone else, I think it'd be cool to look at that a little more closely.
Yes?
So you were saying that in the end, the sea urchin population has been increasing here along the California coast. Have you been
You mean like outside of Monterey? There definitely have been, do you know the update on the Aleutians? So short answer is probably, but I don't have that information right now. Okay, so Jenna asked why there's more urchins around here, and what we think is happening is a few years ago there was a sea star wasting disease that went along pretty much the entire west coast and really wiped out that population. I'm on the spot. Okay. And so sunflower stars, paisaster stars, potentially also consume urchins that are smaller, and when they were gone, the urchin population was able to really increase. I think some people might have thought sea otters should have been able to stop that from happening. So one of the questions is, how do both sea otters and these different sea stars contribute to maintaining that urchin population? It may not be quite as simple as that example Jenna showed earlier. There may be more players in the game than we, well, maybe not thought, but have documented.
Yeah, it's certainly true that in California there are more players in that kelp forest, kelp otter urchin trophic cascade. There are more characters involved in that in California than there are in a simple system. So it's pretty common.
Thank you, guys.
Research coordinator for the sea otter program here at the Monterey Bay Aquarium. Michelle has been studying sea otters at the aquarium since what year did you start? And after we go back to
81, something like that.
Okay, so
can you use the microphone?
Sorry, I have a much quieter voice than Jenna does.
Yeah.
I've been studying otters. I've been working at the aquarium since 1986, But I studied otters before then, about 4 years before that time, when I was a student at UC Santa Cruz. So if you have questions for the old, you know, old-timer type questions, that's why I'm here.
So there were techniques for research that were demonstrated in that video that are very similar to those used today. And there are techniques that have changed quite a bit. So I'm talking about the first half of the video before the hand feeding started, which I will tell you that Jack Ames wanted me to be sure and say that he had no idea that they were going to go do that after they dropped off the two mycologists. He had nothing to do with the hand feeding element. Anyway, so what were some of the things that we saw them use when they're capturing otters for tagging? Yes. The Wilson trap, right? So how has that changed?
So we still use the Wilson trap. The only difference is instead of using the pole, like you saw a broomstick basically attached to that, we attach it to a Tekna or an underwater scooter, and the divers can actually swim along, and it's much easier to swim along with a device that's actually propelling you along to go up underneath the otter and have that push you up with the scooter on the car with the trap on top instead of having to physically do it yourself. It's pretty, Jack said it was very difficult to actually, even with two people pushing that trap up there. I know Marlin made it look real simple, but it wasn't to get the animal up there. The other part is the yellow balloons, the yellow floats. We used those for quite a long time, but it was one of the main things that the first thing the otter would do when it got in the trap was bite it, and the balloon popped, so it really wasn't useful anyway, so we took those off right away. And then another part of that trap is we found over the years that otters would, as you saw, the otter was biting it, if you noticed that. We found out that they like to bite the trap because they're trying to get out of it, so we had to pad all of the parts of the trap that the otter could get to so that they don't break teeth on it. But we still use the same design, we just have modified it a little bit to make it even more safe for the individual otters and make it easier for the divers to use when they're going up underwater.
Yes, Jim?
In the film, they were using probably state-of-the-art scuba gear at the time, but did you use rebreathers then?
Right. Yeah, but actually, if you notice, they were using scuba gear, and you saw a lot of the bubbles that were floating up underneath. Well, over the years when we started doing that, either the otters got smarter, and when, as soon as the diver got underneath, oh, and another point I wanted to make is that Marlin wanted to capture animals that were foraging, and as Jenna said, we never capture a foraging otter, we always capture a resting otter, and mainly in the kelp. So when the divers would get under the kelp with that scuba gear, the bubbles would start coming up to the surface, and the otters would immediately could smell. They have a very good sense of smell, and as the bubbles pop, they could smell the pastrami sandwich breath that the diver might have had before we came down underwater. So at some point, the Navy was developing a diving gear called rebreathers, where it actually recirculates their air so the bubbles don't come out. So we tried an experiment, and the divers went out one day, and they used the scuba gear, and we caught maybe two or three otters, and then the next day we went out using rebreathers and we caught 18 otters because they didn't know that the bubbles and the divers, well, there were no bubbles, so when the divers were underneath they didn't recognize that they were under there. So that we've been using those for probably about 25 years now using the rebreathers, and they do work a lot better.
So what else did you notice? Maybe something about the flipper tags? One tag, yellow 4, was going to be the distinguishing flipper tag for that otter. Could we get away with otter yellow 4 these days?
Not nowadays. And those were metal tags also. So they were very round tags and they were kind of sharp. And nowadays we use a plastic tag. We've been using that for many, many years as well, and it's a temple tag used for cows and goats. So if you had a cow farm, you could put a flipper tag or a plastic tag in the cow's ear, and that what works best in sea otters right now. And goes in between. We have one on each foot, We also have different positions that we put them on each foot so that we can determine whether it's a male or a female. And then we can determine what location it came from. So by color, we might put a different color on the right foot if an otter was captured in Monterey compared to one that was captured in Santa Cruz. So we would know where the otter was from initially. And then the other foot on the left foot would be an identifying tag for the otter itself, and that would make it unique.
So an otter tracker has to be able to see what color both of the tags are, which toes each of the tags are between, and which foot the different colors are on. And they have to do that through a Questar, which is a mirror-based scope, and it reverses everything. So you have to teach everyone that's looking through the Questar that right is left and left is right. And I can tell you, and I think Michelle is probably the same way, that after 15 years of doing this, I'm the wrong person to ask for driving directions.
We don't know from our left, our lefts from our rights anymore. So.
Any other questions? Yeah.
I'm assuming that the amounts of data or samplings that you take in the field has increased. Do you do blood draws? Are you taking samples of fur? Are you looking? Are you trying to look at their teeth at all? Their overall health? You know, what all you pretty much did was weigh it.
Yeah, all they did back then was wait. And then the other thing they did is they didn't do it with them asleep or anesthetized. So that stresses them out quite a bit. And so what we do now is we just capture the animal with the Wilson trap, but we have a big box called a capture box, and we put them in the box, which is dark, and they can become more relaxed in that box. It has holes, of course, in it to allow air and water in as we need. And then we bring them to, like, say, the aquarium's animal health lab, and then the animal gets anesthetized.
Oh.
So when we're processing them, when we're putting the flipper tags in, they're asleep. They don't remember anything. The drug that they use or we use is called fentanyl and midazolam, and many of you have probably had that drug if you've had different types of procedures in your lifetime. And if you haven't, you will in the future, believe me. and you don't remember a thing from taking it. And so with each otter, we try to get every single sample that we can for all kinds of different researchers. So people that are looking at bite force, people that want to look at baseline blood values, people that want to look at domoic acid in the blood, or looking at toxoplasmosis signatures for that in the otter. We take fur samples. We do all kinds of morphometrics. We stick swabs in different parts of their body to get saliva and poop and all those lovely things. And there's probably a couple dozen things that we get from them too. And so that we're trying to combine efforts so that not, you know, more people. You don't want to have this research group going out and collecting otters and that research group going out and collecting otters. So we're doing it for everybody at one time.
The Southern Sea Otter Research Alliance?
No,
single hand.
Which part of it?
Just what it is.
Southern Sea Otter Research Alliance is a group of lots of people that work together. It's USGS, UC Santa Cruz, Monterey Bay Aquarium. We work with the Marine Mammal Center. State Cal Fish and Wildlife, U.S. Fish and Wildlife, and we all work together. Basically, it is one of the few species where the people that are studying that species actually work together instead of working against each other or arguing about whose data is what. We all share data, and we all work. It's a nice, big, happy family most of the time. So, yeah, it's pretty fun. We work together doing a lot of proposals. Esner, I really am sorry, Ron, I forgot them too, because we work with them as well. The Elkhorn Slough National Estuary Research Reserve. It's always a mouthful for me to say. We also work with them, so it's all part of the Southern Sea Otter Alliance. Yes?
And why do you use a telescope that reverses images, and what's the current thinking about subspecies versus species? I mean, it used to be two subspecies, and then I've seen three subspecies or even species of sea otter.
Okay, well, the scope that we use is probably, especially for the foraging data, it is probably the best scope you can ever use to get close enough to identify those little tiny snails that Jess was telling you about under their armpits. And if you've never used one, you can come out and use it with us and see how good it is, because we really love using those. We do use like Nikon and Bushnell spotting scopes, and we use those just for finding the otters and maybe finding flipper tags. Some people like to use them for that. We're a little bit picky about what we want to use for the foraging data, so we use the Questar scopes. And then the question about the subspecies, there's actually three subspecies. There's the ones in, Southern California, so in Hydrolutris nereus, sorry. Then there's Alaska, which is the Hydrolutris canyoni. There's so along the California, Alaskan coast all the way out to the Aleutian Islands. And then you have the species over by Russia as well, and that's in Hydrolutris. And they go all the way down the coast, or around the, basically the Pacific Rim, and you get some down in the coast, along the coast of Japan. Not many, but occasionally there's sea otters down there, and they're the same species as Russia.
Shall correct me if I'm wrong, but...
Sorry?
Nobody's arguing that they're separate species, it's subspecies.
Subspecies, yes.
So correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that the California, the southern sea otter is the most genetically distinct, because we're so far removed, and that it may have even been distinct back prior to them, fur trade.
Yeah, when you look at microsatellite DNA, stuff with sea otters, and they determine all the different parts that are going on in there. The California sea otter had a lot of different things in them than the Alaskan otters and the Russian otters. So they think maybe the Alaskan and the Russian have a bunch of mixing going on between them, but the population in California has a few things that are separate. So it could either mean that they never were near each other, or that they've been separated for so long that things have changed a little bit for them. Any other questions? Yes?
I have a question for the first segment. You, I just thought that sea otters were really cute and cuddly. That's kind of why I wanted to go tonight. And you said that, and I have a sea otter from the aquarium that I have to hold every night and just like, you know, talk to. It's bizarre. I know I'm an adult, but I just love it. And now I kind of feel I'm actually kind of scared. I know that's bad. I feel a little scared of them. And they have these sharp, you were saying. They're really sharp teeth, and they said they're hard. Well, I was curious, though, to look it up. It's a wolf pack. They're part of the wolf. What are
they? Castellan. So weasels.
Weasels.
Oh, weasels.
Weasels. So yeah. I said wolverine.
Oh, wolverine. Yeah.
Yeah. So they're sort of sea wolverines in a way. And people often ask me, when I was a researcher, they would ask me, how often do you get to hug them? Do you get to pet them all the time? And I would say no, and they wouldn't want me to, and I really wouldn't want to. And have you ever heard of a wolverine? And, and so they're carnivores. They have teeth. They certainly will try to bite to defend themselves, and they are they're very loose in their skin, right? So they can turn around and bite someone that's like maybe trying to pet them on the back. So what we really don't want to see is these animals getting so used to people that they're just climbing up on kayaks. We already do see them climbing up on kayaks, and we really want to try to discourage that behavior, because, as I mentioned, it takes a little bit away from their wildness, for one thing, and it encourages them to be bolder and bolder and bolder, and then we have problem interactions where people are bitten, pets are bitten or killed, and then the otter is the one that pays. The otter has to be removed from the population. That's just the way it happens in today's society, is that the wildlife is the one that ends up paying the price. So, yeah, these are not cuddly pets. These are, you can go ahead and keep hugging your plush the otter. That's okay with me. But just recognize the difference between the otter that's living its life in the wild and the one that you have at home.
Just
don't
want anybody to see you.
Do you see problems with role models?
Yes.
And the genetics due to the kind of bottleneck that the subpopulation here, or the subspecies in California, being that they're so separated from any other population, and that they bottleneck to 50 individuals, mm-hmm. whatever it is, are there problems that they see?
That was kind of the start of a lot of the research for the genetic stuff, is the bottleneck, people wondering if they were bottleneck. And so far we haven't really seen anything related to that, although there is another person, they're doing the genome for sea otters now, and they're trying to see if they could find anything from that, but we haven't seen any of the recent results on it. And getting back to your stuffed sea otter question, not question, but comment. They do bite, and I've been bitten a couple of times, and it hurts. And I could tell you other story, like Jack Ames, the guy in this, he's been bit quite a few times, and someone else that works here has been bit quite a few times. Jack's was probably the worst when I saw a sea otter nail his toe into the side of the boat because he was trying to wrestle it a little bit. So, yeah, they can hurt a lot. But they're soft, stuffed animals. They're really cuddly and nice. Yeah.
So I'd like to hear what you think about the hounds feeding in the video. So I can remember, so today one of the things that I don't see hounds feeding of sea otters very often. I don't know. I think it probably does happen. I've heard reports of it happening. Ron, have you ever heard of anyone feeding? Yeah, Ron's heard about everything. Maybe you can share that story with us. Did it look like that inflatable?
No.
Were they photographers, mainly? People that try to take pictures usually are trying to feed them.
But photographers, you know, I think we're lucky that the respect photographers have for nature now is much more than
it
was
should be.
Back then. I mean, sometimes they push you to get little clothes or stuff like that, but nothing feeding or anything like that.
So I was just going to relate a story from my childhood. One of my favorite childhood memories is going down to the beach with my dad, and we had a bag of Wonder Bread. And we would feed this entire bag of Wonder Bread to the seagulls and the squirrels down at the beach in Southern California. And now, one of my pet peeves when I'm out working in the field, a lot of the places where we observe sea otters have lots of ground squirrels and lots of gulls. And one of my missions in life is to educate people about not feeding squirrels and gulls, and especially not junk food and things, food that's bad for us. And so I just think it's really interesting how times have changed and attitudes have changed towards wildlife and what was okay, acceptable to do. Obviously, Marlon Perkins, a guy who had a lot of experience, he was a television personality for sure, but he had a lot of experience interacting with wildlife, and he thought that was perfectly reasonable to hand feed sea otters and encourage them to come closer and be friendly and unafraid. And now we really have changed our perspective on that. Does anybody have any thoughts or stories they want to share about that? Yep.
Something similar. I bought some DVD copies of a really old show about the ocean,
mm-hmm.
and when they were going down in coral reefs, they were doing things like putting their hands all over the coral and resting their equipment onto it, and doing all the stuff that you would never do in documentary cameras.
We really do have to be more careful about our impact and all the things we do. The planet's getting pretty crowded, and
observation. I still think of myself as not yet a Californian, since I just moved here a little over a year ago from Michigan. And I live in Carmel, and I've obviously fallen in love with the coast. Being a water person, all Michiganders love the water. So in any event, I am surprised at the ability or the access that they give along, I'm thinking of Point Pinos, the Sillamar area, to the tidal pools and to the rocky area, and I watched, despite the signage, which is I think too subtle, of do not take, you know, leave it in place, do not pick it up, of the animals and plants in the tidal pools. I've watched people bring sea stars up. I see them collecting things right out of the tidal pool and sticking in the jars and then running around showing everybody. You know, I stand there and I think, I'm not the park police. I have said things, try to say it nicely to people, please read the sign, you need to be careful, these are animals that are, they need to be protected, and picking them up is damaging them, and could kill them, and they just kind of look at me, so anyways, that kind of bothers me. I question the access to areas. The reason I'm saying that, in Michigan, are a lot of the wetland areas that are protected, are you cannot access them. The access will be limited. There'll be an elevated walkway, and then it stops. And there's signage that's saying the reason that we are only going so far is to protect the wildlife. That they have the right to this area, we don't. We're the visitor. They're the ones who live here. And anyway, so I just kind of wonder about that.
Yeah, there really is a fine balance between allowing people access so they can enjoy and experience wildlife and making sure that we protect the wildlife that we love or are interested in at the same time. And I think that's sort of a work in progress, and a lot of people are really recognizing the importance of protecting these areas. We just recently, Seattle Savvy collaborated with Monterey Bay Aquarium, California State Parks, U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, California Department of Fish and Wildlife, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, to close a very popular beach in Moss Landing to allow sea otters to be able to haul out and rest there. It was an effort that took a considerable amount of effort and time and planning and communication to get all those people together. So I think there are changes, and we are starting to recognize that we need to set some space aside. But there is still a dialogue and disagreement between human beings about what's more important than access or protection.
The dogs run in the wintertime when I'm a birder, all these sanderlings are on the beach, and then these dogs are running into all of the shorebirds, and I'm standing there like my hair was on fire. What is going on here? So anyways,
we can come volunteer for Sea Otter Savvy.
I'm going to be shortbird Savvy too, though.
Yeah, absolutely. We do all species. So I'm going to wrap it up. If you have any more questions, feel free and come on up front. I have some Respect the Nap stickers, which you can take for free. I have volunteer flyers if anyone's interested in volunteering for Sea Otter Savvy. Some Sea Otter Savvy information in here, and also a schedule for the Sea Otter Awareness Week. Tomorrow is the last day, but there's still some things happening throughout the Monterey Bay area, and that's on here. And again, I want to encourage you to try to make it up to Santa Cruz tomorrow at 5:30 for Dr. Tinker's once-in-a-lifetime talk. So with that, I will end the evening. Thank you so much, Jessica. Thank you all for coming. Thanks to the Monterey Bay Aquarium for providing this incredible facility. Thanks very much.